All week long, we've been talking about justification and what justification is, and so how we receive justification. We receive it by faith in the works that Jesus Christ has done, and we recognize that we are not worthy of all of the things that Jesus Christ has done for us. Not a single one of us is worthy, and all humanity that is alive now, that ever has lived or ever will live, all of them combined together is not worthy of what Jesus Christ has done upon the cross of Calvary. So when we begin to recognize that, we look at Romans chapter 12 and verse 1. The Apostle Paul says, "Therefore I urge you." And so when you see that word "therefore," you recognize, you know, that word's there for a reason. It's there to, tell us to look back a little bit. What's he been talking about? And so when we look at that word "therefore," what we recognize then, "Therefore I urge you, brethren," the Apostle Paul says, "therefore I believe," in accordance to everything that he's already laid out in the book of Romans. And so when we look at the book of Romans here, what does the Apostle Paul have done? He has told us in the first three chapters that we are guilty, that we're, every one of us are guilty of the sin that we have committed, and so we're worthy of the wrath of God and the condemnation of God, and we're worthy of death. And so he has laid that out very, very clearly. And then in Romans chapter 4 and chapter 5, he's talking about the justification that is then offered to us through the bloodshed of Jesus Christ, and that Jesus went to the cross of Calvary to die for us, to save us. And then we begin to recognize that new birth, that new life that comes to us, and through the dying to ourselves that we begin to find, and coming alive to Jesus Christ and him giving to us, as we find in Romans chapter 8, the power of his Holy Spirit that then enables for us to live victorious, holy lives. And so as we look at it all in a nutshell, we recognize that every bit of it, God's justification, everything that God has done is by his grace. And so when the Apostle Paul is saying, "Therefore, I urge you, brethren," he's saying, look backwards. Look at the entire book of Romans. And so with that in mind, "Therefore, I urge you," an urging, not a commanding, not a demanding. Now, certainly God can, but he urges us rather. He says, "I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God," the mercies of God, that we deserve death, hell, and condemnation. Instead, he gave to us redemption, salvation. He gave to us justification. "So therefore, I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies," that means every bit of who you are, "your bodies as a living," God wants us to be a living sacrifice, not a dead sacrifice. "So as a living and holy sacrifice," that word "holy" means to be set apart. So we're a living sacrifice for God. We are a holy, set apart sacrifice for God, acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. In other words, when we begin to understand that what it is that Jesus Christ has done for us, friends, we ought to be absolutely surrendered and absolutely sold out to God in every way, shape, and form. We deserve death, hell, and condemnation. Instead, he gives to us redemption, that which is through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. That redemption results into justification. That justification, then through that we can have that glorious relationship with God and be in right relationship with God and be in peace with him. With that understanding, we ought to be the most dedicated, the most sold out, the most surrendered people on the face of this earth, because we know what we deserve, yet we know what he gave to us instead. Praise God. "I urge you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice." Sounds like a lot to ask. but not when we understand what he's done and what he's given.